So Pahom is trying to hurry back, but he is in a terrible shape, and that is where part nine starts. He realizes that he has come very far, and now it is very difficult for him to go back before the sun sets. And he's already in a terrible shape. He's panting, he's breathless, his feet are bruised, they are bleeding, he is sweating, he's dehydrated. He has no food on him, but somehow he knows that he has to reach that spot from where he started his journey in the morning. So he breaks into a run and he starts running, and he runs desperately. And in fact, the story builds into a climax, and I will read out for you. So he And he keeps panicking. There's mounting tension and there's mounting panic. And he keeps thinking to himself, what shall I do? I have grasped too much and ruined the whole affair. I can't get there before the sun sets. So he realizes that he has actually bitten off more than he can chew. So in his greed and his temptation, he has gone on and on, forgetting to return. So that's the symbolic relevance of the whole narrative. And this fear that he can't return to that spot and the whole day's effort is going to go waste made him still more breathless. Pahom went on running, his soaking shirt and trousers stuck to him, and his mouth was parched. It was absolutely dry. His breast was working like a blacksmith's bellows, so he could actually almost hear his heart thumping and pumping. His heart was beating like a hammer, and his legs were giving way as if they did not belong to him. Pahom was seized with terror lest he should die of the strain. So he felt so much under pressure, he felt so much under strain that he thought he'll have a heart attack and now he's going to die. But he could not stop. Though he was afraid of death, he kept running and he said, no, after having run all this way, I can't stop now. And he could just see the sun, touching the rim on the horizon. And he was like, oh my God, the sun is about to set. And just before the sun sets, sometimes there's an illusion and it becomes like a red colored ball, and that's what Pahom could see now. And he could already see the people on the hillock. They were waving their arms at Pahom, telling him to hurry up. I mean, they were gesturing him to hurry up. And he could almost see the cap also on the ground and the money on it, and the chief sitting in his place. And he was holding both his sides, and Pahom could see him laughing. And suddenly Pahom recalls the nightmare he has had, the vision he has had of the chief laughing. And Pahom says, no, but I have to hurry. And he just hurries and he touches the cap and he falls on the ground. And the chief says, oh, that's a wonderful day's work, and yes, all of this land is yours. And the servant, Pahom's servant, steps forward to pick his master up, and when he turns him around, what he sees is Pahom is dead. He is dying with blood foaming out of his mouth, frothy blood coming out of his mouth. The exhaustion has killed him. And so the servant simply picks up a spade and he digs a grave, a 6 feet long hole in the ground, and he puts his master in it. And he digs a grave for his master, and that is where the story ends. So it's all about how much land does a man actually need? Just enough for his grave, So that's the message which Tolstoy is trying to give us, that in our mad pursuit of material possessions, of land, of property, of wealth, of power, we forget who we are. We compromise our family, we forget our relations, we forget our loved ones, we forget that we have to take care of ourselves, we take our body for granted. And finally, all of this for what? Because at the end of the day, when we die, we cannot take anything with us.